It's an honor for me to be here on the stage with one of my favorite anime directors, Shinkai Makoto, and I really urge you to go see his new film tomorrow when it's screened here at the New York Anime Festival. It's a great opportunity. We're just going to talk about a few sort of topics that we've tossed back and forth and to sort of introduce some of you who might not know much about Shinkai-san, but also to explore some of his themes and ideas and obsessions in his work. As Vin said, he's one of the very few young anime artists who is compared favorably with Hayao Miyazaki in Japan, even though he doesn't accept that at all. So I want to talk a little bit about his work as an artist. So the first thing I'd like to address is, Shinkai-san, is your background, which, as some of you may know, Shinkai-san does not come from a conventional illustrator's background. Anime in Japan is still very much a 2D, hand-drawn, labor-intensive art form. Shinkai-san has a background in computer graphics and in the gaming industry. So my first question is, how does that affect you as an artist? How does that make you different from a conventional or traditional anime artist?
So first of all, I want to say thank you for them. Hello everyone. No, actually, my English is very bad, so I need to have the translator to help me. But just so thank you for coming here, and this is the first time for me coming to New York. It's a very big city. yeah, amazing. So after this panel, I want to go to Apple Store. I hope you enjoy this panel. So, please.
Thanks.
どのようにその僕のバックグラウンドがその他の方と違うかというと、多分僕は一番最初デジタルでアニメーションを作り始めたんですね。他のジブリとかのスタジオはもちろんこうアナログから、背景を描いてるわけですよね。そこが大きな違いだと思います。まず最初。
So first of all, like we said, my background is in digital, whereas, for example, in traditional places like Ghibli, they do everything hand-drawn.
僕がその最初にアニメーションを作り始めた時は、僕はまだアマチュアで、ゲーム会社に勤めてたんですね。で、まあ、アニメーションのようなものを作りたいと思って、自分でこう、どういうふうに作っていっていいかなと思った時に、自分の手元にあったのが、Photoshop であり、After Effects というその、Adobe のデジタルツールだったので、まあ、見よう見真似で、そういうデジタルツールを使って、まあ、背景をね、描き始めたのが最初のきっかけでした。
When I first started making these videos, I was an amateur, I was working in a gaming company, and, but I really wanted to make animation. So I didn't really have anything special, no special tools at my disposal, so I just used what I had, like Photoshop, and that's really how I started.
You also did, obviously you created, as Vince noted, She and Her Cat on your own. do you think that having the background that you have in CGI enables you to be a more generous artist? And you know, as many of you know, Shinkai-san is a triple threat, basically writes, illustrates, animates, directs. He does the whole thing. He's an anime auteur of the highest order. Do you think your background in computers and digital graphics helps you?
そうだと思いますね。It's helped me a lot. ですね。僕が最初アニメ作り始めた時には、僕一人で始めたので、なるべく効率的にたくさんの絵を描く必要があったんですね。で、それを1998年ぐらいから作り始めたんですけど、その時、ちょうどデジタルカメラっていうものが安くなってきて、みんなが使うようになってきて、で僕はデジタルカメラを使って、日常の風景の写真を撮って、デジタルカメラって撮った時点でもうそれが、ね、データですから、コンピューター。それをフォトショップで読み込んで、それをもとに絵を描くような 方法をとって、その、まあ、なるべく短い時間で一人でたくさんの絵を描くっていう、その生産性につなげていきました。
So, this was in around 1998 when I started making Amishian Manhattan. What I did was, at that time, cameras became really cheap and anyone started using them. So I started going around and I took my digital camera and I took photos of cityscapes and the streets and I used those images, uploaded to my computer and used those as the foundation for the drawings that I made. And since I was working alone, I had to draw a lot of pictures, just drawing a lot of pictures, but it all came together.
This is going to be a kind of user-friendly question. I know from other conventions I've attended and from this one that there are usually a number of people in the audience who wouldn't mind becoming animators themselves if they aren't already. So I wonder, since we're on this topic, what kind of advice would you give to someone today who sees your work and your accomplishments and would like to pursue the kind of art that you make?
ですね、僕が作り始めた、まあ、10年前に比べても今の方が環境は整っていると思うんですね。まあ、いいソフトもいいハードもあるし、インターネットがあるので作ってすぐに人前に出して反応を得ることができるし、それはすごく、まあ、羨ましくて、まあ、どんどんね、やるといいんじゃないかというふうには思うんですけど、同時に物を作って外に出すまでが簡単にできすぎてしまって、なんだろう、自分の中にその何を作りたいのかというものをじっくり考える時間というのは短くなってるんじゃないかと思うんですよね。その作りたいものを自分の中に溜め込んで、まあ、出していくというのは、成熟する時間が短くなってるんじゃないかと。ですから簡単にものを発表できてしまうことはいいことでもあるけれど、同時にそれが、まあ、デメリットにもなりうるので、なんだろうな、まあ、なるべく作りたいものを自分の中で成熟させる時間を大事にとって、で、実際の発表はデジタルの力を借りてね、インターネットなどに大きく出していけば、うまくいくかもしれないというふうに思います。
Well, I mean, compared to when I started 10 years ago, now the technology is amazing. There's so many things that you guys can use to support you, to help you with your animation. And now, you can really easily get this information out to just about anyone in many different ways. Because of that, though, I think that the amount of time that people take to really develop their ideas has gotten shorter. So I think it's really important to not only take advantage of these tools that you have at your disposal, but also to really take the time to develop these ideas within yourself and really think about what you want to animate, and then you can use these tools to create what you want to create.
It's interesting, you talked about using photographs and walking around with a digital camera and taking a lot of pictures for the illustrations. And I'm wondering what drew you personally to create animation? Because, I actually mentioned your use of photographs to a friend of mine recently in Boston, and she quite innocently said, well, why didn't he just use the photographs? If he's taking these great photographs, why not just be a photographer or use the photos? Instead, obviously, you're using the photos to make animation. Why do you do that?
まあ、いくつかの理由があるんですけど、一つにはやはり僕は人の手で描かれた絵が好きだということです。で、まあ、だったら最初から絵で描けばいいんですが、ただアニメーションというのは一枚の絵を描いただけでは終わらないので、たくさんの絵を描く必要があると。で、そういうたくさんの絵を描く、短い時間で描くために、写真を元にしているというのが、まず一つ目の理由です。
Well, one reason is that I personally really, really like hand-drawn animation. However, again, just as you guys know, when you're doing hand-drawn animation, it's not just one picture, it's many, many, many pictures put together. And that takes a lot of time. So I use the photos to sort of shorten the amount of time that's required to draw these pictures, but it's to like the effect of the hand-drawn pictures.
もう一つの理由はですね、そのアニメーションを作り始めたときに、どうして作り始めたかというと、まあ、僕はその東京でずっと暮らしていて、で、まあ、東京のね、こう、いかにも東京的な狭いアパートの一室で暮らしていたわけですけど、まあ、そんなにね、ニューヨークやなんかのこう都市と比べて美しい風景ではないんですけれども、でも自分のその住んでる場所を美しい場所だと思いたかったんですよね。例えば、電線で空が覆われてる景色とか、まあ、ポスト いろいろポスティングされたものが溢れているその風景とか自分のいる日常を美しいものとしてアニメーションで描ければあの、まあ、自分の生活もねそんなに悪いものじゃないかないんじゃないかというふうに思えると思ったんですね。ですのでそのためには写真をそのまま使ってはそのなんだろう写真よりももっと現実の風景を美しいものにする必要があったんです。なのでその写真を元にはするんだけれどもそれをさらに美しいところをもっと誇張して、さらに現実の風景よりも美しい現実の風景というものを映像にしていく必要がありました。
And then the other thing as to why I actually started doing this、you know, I live in Tokyo and just like any other major city, you know, like Tokyo, New York, people say they're not really beautiful cities、however, I really wanted to think of my city as a beautiful citySo, you know, things like an image of like the sky through the buildings or, you know, a bunch of letters sticking out of a mailbox. You know, little moments like this I think are really beautiful and I wanted to capture that. So I would take photos of the cityscape and then use that as a foundation to draw something even more beautiful. I wanted to create not only a beautiful city just sort of in my mind but also in reality.
Would you ever consider setting a film in the ugly city of New York?
New York で。
ニューヨークはね、あのすごくこういろんな作品に使われてるので、今更僕がね、もう。
Well, you know, New York is already the location for a lot of things that exist, so even if I do that now, I mean, it's not really...
At least there's an Apple store. okay, let's talk a little bit about storytelling and writing.We're looking at the gorgeous visuals on the screen, but as many of you know who've seen Shinkai-san's films, and, it's not merely a beautiful thing to look at, but the stories are quite moving and quite profound. In fact, when I was in Tokyo, I showed 5 centimeters per second to a writer friend of mine, and he just felt the quality of the stories themselves, it's three linked short fictions, actually.It was just astonishing. Can you talk a little bit about your writing process, Shinkai-san? How you start drafting a story and how it comes together?
ですね、まあ作品によってちょっとずつ違うんですけど、一番最初に思い浮かぶのは、大体言葉なんですね。登場人物のセリフです。あの、例えば秒速5センチメートルでは、ヒロインの女の子が、来年も一緒に桜が見れるといいよねっていうふうに言うんですけど、あ、そういう言葉がまあ、あの、普通にこう街を歩いてると思い浮かんだりするんですね。それを書き留めておいて家に帰ってそのセリフを言わせるためにはどういう物語が必要かというのを、まあ、後からじっくり組み立てていくという形を取ることが多いんですね。
So, actually I start with words. In 5 centimeters per second, one of the lines that one of the characters says is, I hope that we can see the cherry blossoms together again next year.So using that line, I think about what sort of an image, what sort of a situation you would have that sort of a line, and then the story sort of grows from there.
あとはですね、例えば、よくそのどうやって物語書いてるんですかって聞かれるんですけど、あともう一つ、その僕はまあいろんな人に影響を受けてるんですけど、一つは村上春樹の作品がすごく好きだったんですね。大学でも国文学の勉強していたんですけど、まああまり勉強しないで村上の作品ばかり読んでいたんですが、で、文章を書くことが、まあ、彼の影響もあると思うんですが、すごく好きなんです。ですから、最終的に作るのは映像なんですけど、最初小説のような形で、まず、まあ文章で、仕上げていくんですね。そう、まあ、それがね、もう一つのやり方。
Well, and another thing I do is I take inspiration from the works that I like. When I was a student, I actually was a literature major, but really I just spent all of my time reading Miyazaki's books, which I really, really enjoy. Murakami Haruki's novels. Sorry. And this is a question I'm asked often. So that's another thing that I do is I look for inspiration from the works that I really enjoy.
It struck me very recently, actually, after finishing Murakami Haruki's forthcoming novel, Ichikyuhachiyon, 1Q84, I guess, in English, which won't surprise, is not a giveaway to anyone, features a love story. and a story of two people who are trying to get back together after having an initial encounter, a romantic encounter. I'm not telling anymore. But of course, as I was reading it, I suddenly thought, wow, that seems familiar. And as many of you know who've seen Shinkai-san's work, they often feature love stories, and often quite melancholic love stories about losing touch, losing contact with the person of your affections. So I wondered if I could ask you a kind of blunt question. Do you think love is doomed?
まあ運命だと信じたいですけれど、まあ実際は多分以前するぐらいですね。あの、思うんですよね。あの、で、まあ現実の恋愛はうまくいくことよりも、あの確率的にはうまくいかないことの方が多いわけです。あそこの相手と誰もが結ばれるわけではないですから。ですので、あのアニメーション作品の中でも、この人とこの人は結ばれてうまくいきましたよという話を書くよりは、不幸にもね、恋愛は叶わなかった。でも、それでも、それでも別に全てそれで絶望する必要はなくて、他にも美しいものや幸せなものっていうのは他にもあるんだよっていうことを、あの作品の中で示すことができれば、その方が共感を、持ってもらうことができるんじゃないかと思って、まあ、非恋もね、うまくいかない恋愛を描いています。
Well, I mean, I think love isn't doomed, of course. But, you know, in real life, love doesn't always work out. You know, sometimes your first love, you don't end up with that person that you fell in love with and things like that. So, I mean, I think I'm just really reflecting what real life is like. And also, you know, in the stories, even if you don't end up with the person you like, you can still enjoy life and you can still enjoy the beautiful things in life. And I think that that's really the message that I was trying to portray.
It's good because I happen to think love is doomed, but that's... seriously, another element of Shinkai-san's films, and obviously we've talked about visuals here a little bit about story, but also the music is just so well selected. I think it merges at the right point in the film. It doesn't overwhelm the film. A brilliant selection of music for the soundtrack. I wonder if you could just talk a little bit about that process, how you go about selecting music.
そうですね。作品ごとに違うんですけど、秒速5センチメートルの時には、まず、ストーリーを書いて、で、そのストーリーが、日本で90年代の少し昔の話でしたので、90年代の日本のヒットソングを使いたいと思って、まあ、たくさんの、まあ、ポップソングを聴いて、その中で一番イメージに合うものが、山崎まさよしのワンマンタイムワンマンチャンスという曲だったんですね。
Well, I mean, it depends on the movie, but for example, for 5 cm/s, I decided after creating the story that I wanted to use a song from the 90s. So I listened to a lot of popular hit songs from the 90s, and ultimately the one that I liked was the one that you hear in the movie, which is One More Life, One More Chance.
で、次回作の、明日見ていただける星を子供という作品では、熊木杏里という熊木さんっていうね、シンガーソングライターの方に主題歌を書いてもらったんですけど、映画のために。映画が終わって最後に撮ってつけたように有名な人の曲が流れるという形にはしたくなかったので、熊木さんという、アーティストの方に頻繁にスタジオに通ってもらって、コンテも読んでもらって、脚本も読んでもらって、スタッフも紹介して、で、作品の制作チームの一員になってもらって、で、彼女にその中から出てくる気持ちを曲にしてもらいました。ですから、星を子供の音楽は多分作品のその本質にマッチしたものになってるんじゃないかと思います。
And then, for example, and as you will hear if you go to the premiere tomorrow, in Children Who Chase,
The Lost Voices,
there was a person whose name was Kumaki, and she actually, I didn't want to use a famous person's song. So what we did was we found her and we invited her to come down to the studio. She met the staff, she read the script, and she really became a member of the team. And then she created the song from the feelings that she developed as being a team member for this movie. So, you know, it's not like an independent project. She really was part of the creation of the movie.
あとまあもう一つあのバックグラウンドミュージック BGM についてなんですけど、僕はあのこの10年間ずっと天文さんという、まあ作曲家とずっと組んでね一緒にやってるんですね。彼はもともと僕のゲーム会社時代の先輩だったんですけれども、まあ彼はですね、例えば映画を作るとなって、こういう曲が必要だって言って彼にまあお願いするわけですけど、で当然それがイメージに合わない時があるわけですよね。ですからリテイクを出して作り直してくださいというふうに、まあ心苦しいんですがお願いするんですが、でもまあ彼はね、それをこう嫌な顔せずに何度言っても10回 NG を出しても、10回ともね、ニコニコ笑ってね、作り直してくれるわけですよね。まあそういう音楽家との密接なやりとりというのを作品ごとに全てやっています。
Also, if you guys notice from the movies, someone that I use very frequently as the background music creator for a lot of the movies is Tenmon, is Mr. Tenmon. And he is actually a senior member from the game company that I used to work at. And so, you know, whenever we tell him, you know, we need a song for this, and he would just create it for us. And sometimes, you know, the songs didn't quite match what we were expecting, but, you know, no matter how many times we'd ask him to rewrite it, even if it was 5, 10, 20 times, he would always smile and just...
It raises a very practical question. When you visit anime studios in Japan, they're usually quite small. You're obviously not working solo anymore. Roughly how many people you work with and what your staff does?
ですね、僕たちのスタジオは大体まあ多い時で20人ぐらいメインスタッフがいます。で、多くはアニメーターとバックグラウンドアーティストですね。そのメインスタッフが多い時で、まあ、20人なんですが、星を子供っていう映画全体で言うと、細かな色をね、一枚一枚キャラクターの色を塗る人とかも含めれば200人近くのスタッフがいますが、常勤しているという意味では、まあ、20人ぐらいです。
So, at most we actually have about 20 main staff. I personally am the animator and the background artist.But in terms of any sort of small animations that need to be done or individual character drawings, we have at most about 200 artists that work, 200 staff that work in the studio.
そうですね。あとまあ僕たちのスタジオもそんなに大きくはなくて、まあそんなに狭くもないですけど、人が少ないのでね、そんなに狭くもないんですけど、でもまあカップラーメンはね、よくみんな好きで食べています。星を子供の仕上げの時期に日本に大きな地震があってですね、まあ北陸の方で、北陸じゃないや、東北の方で大震災があったんですが、その時に、まあ、東京もかなり揺れたんですけれども、スタッフの中に韓国人の女の子が一人いてですね、韓国には地震がないので、もうその子はこう泣き叫んで、韓国語で、オムニオムニってお母さんお母さんって泣き叫んでいたんですけれども、彼女のお母さんから韓国からたくさんのこう救援物資みたいなものが段ボールで届いて、その中にはたくさんその辛ラーメンですか、韓国のカップラーメンがたくさん入っていて、それに随分ね助けられました。
Well, I mean, our office is not that big, but there's not very many people, so it doesn't feel that small. However, for example, like, and actually everyone that really does love ramen. when we were making Children Who Chase Lost Voices was actually during that huge earthquake that hit Japan, as you guys all probably know about. and actually, we felt some of that shaking down in Tokyo. And one of the animators actually who works in the, one of the staff who works in the studio is actually from Korea. And she was she doesn't have a lot of experience with earthquakes. She was really scared and was like crying and like, you know, yelling when it happened. And actually her mom sent us a care package from Korea that was, among other things, had a whole bunch of Korean ramen noodles in it. So that really saved us because at that time, you know, food was kind of scarce and there was a lot of problems. So that care package really saved us.
I have nothing against cup ramen. quickly switch over to the new film, because some of you will be attending it tomorrow. To some extent, Children Who Chase Lost Voices is a departure, in a way, from Shinkai-san's earlier work. There's still beautiful imagery. The sort of brilliant rendering of very Japanese textures is in this film as well. And there is, of course, a love story of sorts in the story itself. But the narrative actually takes off into quasi-mythical worlds and almost has an Orpheus nature to it in its exploration of an underworld called Agartha, actually. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about this new film and why you took off in a more epic direction in the story.
ですね、おっしゃる通り、今回の作品は、死者を蘇らせるために、地下の世界に行くという話なんですね。日本だと、日本の神話の古事記というものの中に同じような話はあります。世界的に共通のね、やっぱりテーマだと思うんですよね。死んだものに、死んだ人間にもう一度会いたいのは、そういう話になってますね。
So yes, as you said, this story is a little bit different. In this one, we have the characters who go sort of down to hell, to the underground. They're trying to summon someone who has passed away. And this is something that you can see actually in a traditional Japanese story called the Kojiki, which is a historical story. And you also see it in a lot of epic stories as well.
今回そういう神話的な話にしたのは、大きな理由としては、まず、なんだろう。日本、少なくとも日本を取り巻く日本の社会の雰囲気が制作をしている時に変わったからだと思うんですね。秒速5センチメートルの時はまだ僕たちのその日本の日常というのはこのまま変わらずにずっと続いていくという感覚があったんですね。ですので秒速のようなその日常を美しく描いて、やっぱそれをこう愛おしく愛すことのできるような作品を作りたいと思ってあれを作ったんです。
To answer the question, though, sort of one of the big reasons is, well, for example, when we were doing 5 centimeters per second, at that time, Japan was sort of in an era where it felt like nothing would ever change. So I wanted to make a movie that really sort of reflected that sort of feeling.
その後、その星を子供を作り始めた時は、地震はね、東北の大震災まだ起こる前ではあったんですけど、例えば、リーマンショックがね、アメリカであったりとか、その影響は日本でも小さくなかったので、その日本の日常生活がこのまま続くのだというふうには、もう無条件には信じることができないっていう空気がね、僕たちの社会の中にあったような気がするんですね。少なくとも僕はそういうふうに感じていましたから。ですから、次作る作品は、日本の日常生活を描くものではなくて、日常が失われてしまうような作品にしようと、日常から失われて、それでそれをどう回復するのかという話にしたいと思ったんですね。ですから今回の主人公は異世界に行って、最後は異世界から戻ってくるわけですが、そのようなその神話的な、構造を持った作品にしたわけです。
However, when we made the new movie, there were sort of a lot of things happening, not just in Japan. This is actually before the earthquake happened, but there were things happening around the world, for example, like that earthquake in Chile. That was really starting to have an effect on Japan and really kind of made not only me but really a lot of people think that maybe things would actually not stay the same after all. So I really wanted to create a movie that reflected that sort of change and maybe realizing that yes, things actually are going to start changing. So that's why the main character in the movie has to go to another world and I mean eventually she'll come back, but there's that sort of sense that maybe things are going to be lost, that things are going to change and things will not remain the same.
We talked about the two big M's, Miyazaki and Murakami. Are there any other artists that come to mind, specific artists who you consider influences on your work, or artists that seem like models for you?
最初に思い浮かぶのは、エヴァンゲリオンを作った庵野秀明さんなんです。
First of all, the creator of Evangelion,
エヴァンゲリオンのテレビシリーズの最後の2話って皆さんきっと見たことある人がいると思うんですけど、もうほとんど登場人物の会話とそのね、静止画の繰り返しだけで、技術的には成り立ってるわけです。あれを僕大学生の時に見て、アニメって動かなくてもできるんだというふうに思ったんですよね。庵野さん的には別にそれは忙しくてああいうふうになったのかもしれないし、意図ではなかったのかもしれないんですけど、でもあんなふうに人のしゃべる言葉と静止画の繰り返しだけでも見てるこちらすごく引き込まれたんですよね。ですからエヴァンゲリオンの最後の2話の作り方を見て、アニメ メーションを作ってみたいという気持ちになりました。
I'm sure you guys are aware, but the last few episodes of Eva has some very interesting sort of departed from the rest of the series kind of things going on in there. And you know, when I saw that when I was in college, I thought it was amazing. You know, there are just scenes where not much is happening. And I thought, wow, you know, this is also anime. This is animation. You know, it doesn't always have to be about crazy movements and lots of action. Sometimes it's also about the words that are being spoken or maybe even the lack of words that are not being spoken. So, you know, that really has had a big impact on me.
That's excellent. Have a round of applause for Shinkai-san for putting up with my question.
Thank you.